Well, Ann, too often we feel frustrated, beaten down, ticked off, or shaken up. In other words, bent out of shape. That's the title of a new book by our guest, Karen Hanin. Having practiced as a trial lawyer in downtown Toronto for 20 years, Karen now uses her skills of research and persuasion to communicate life principles that help to reshape what may be bent in our emotional lives. So Karen, thank you for joining us. It's good
to
have you back.
Welcome, Karen. Good to have you.
It's always an honor and a privilege to be here.
Oh, we're so glad you're here.
Now, it seems fascinating to me that you, as a practicing trial lawyer for 20 years, in fact, I think we have
a picture of the early days.
When you were first called to the bar. So there you have it.
That was a long time ago.
1981, is it?
Yes.
All right.
But how does then a trial lawyer with those skills and researching, as I said, and just kind of persuasion, how has that uniquely gifted you for covering a topic such as emotional needs of people?
I approached writing this book the same way I used to approach preparing for any trial. And the first thing is, of course, recognizing that I'm not the expert. I don't pretend to be an expert on emotions. But what I did was I researched a lot of documents, and the main document, of course, is the Bible when we're trying to understand Christian principles. But I also read a lot of good books by experts in the field, but also the emotional journeys of many well-known Christians. And preparing for a trial, I also used to look for the best witnesses. And so, of course, these well-known Christians became my witnesses in this book, testifying about how God has helped them with their emotional journeys. And I'd always look for the experts, so I did the same thing in this book, researching various Christian psychologists and psychiatrists. And my own husband is a family doctor, my brother's a doctor, so I'm surrounded by a medical environment. So I don't pretend to be the expert, but I read lots of books and articles and talked with lots of people. And then finally, in any trial, of course, one always had to find the overriding laws and principles. And so what I did in writing this book was find the scriptural principles and laws that govern our emotions.
Now, you mentioned you resourced some well-known Christians and their stories. Who are you referring to?
Well, there's probably about 5 or 6 dozen different people in there. Okay. So some of them are Christians we've all known about for decades. Corrie ten Boom, for example, I think is an excellent example of somebody who went through a very difficult time being in a concentration camp during World War II. And yet when you read any of her books, you can really see how she journeyed through those years with hope, with faith, with peace in God, and the kind of emotional strength that only Christians can find with God's help. Mm. And somebody like Lisa Beamer, I think a lot of people have read her book. She's the widow of Todd Beamer, who went down with the plane in 9/11. And I think she's another excellent example of somebody who, at a very young age, with 2 kids and a 3rd one on the way, had to deal with very tragic circumstances. And yet, she was able to deal with her anger, her bitterness, her anxiety, and turn all that around into having faith and hope and peace, even during those difficult days.
So some real life testimonial type examples, as well as the witness of experts that you bring to the to the stand, the witness stand in this book. Now, Karen, you kind of group the emotional needs into 4 main areas, and I wish we had time to go through a lot of them, but maybe just kind of touch on those 4 areas, maybe let's zero in on just one.
Okay. I thought of the 4 most troubling clusters of emotions. The first one is anger, which if it's not dealt with turns into resentment and bitterness, maybe even hatred, unforgiveness. The second one is anxiety, fear, worry. And the 3rd one is despair, discouragement, and that can turn into depression. And the 4th one I call the discontentment cluster, which is just discontentment, grumbling, complaining, jealousy. And so I deal with those troubling and difficult emotions, but the other half of the book is about the positive emotions that we can find in our relationship with God. Love, joy, peace, hope. I'm talking a lot today about hope.
So a lot of the opposites to those negative emotions that you find in God's Word.
And one of the reasons I wrote the book was because even in my own personal journey, when I became a Christian many years ago at 19, we're told we're new in Christ, we're new creatures, and there's this spiritual transformation that happens, but our emotions don't change overnight. And so one of the things I thought about as I journeyed through my 20s was, where are the love, joy, and peace? And I felt those emotions a lot of the time, but there were times, like anybody else, I'd feel anger, I'd feel disappointment, I'd feel discouragement, my main thing is worry. I'm a worrier. And so I thought, well, why am I still stuck in some of these difficult and troubling and negative emotions? Why isn't there more love, joy, peace all of the time? Why isn't that our default when we wake up each day? And so in my personal journey, I tried to discover what the Bible said about how we can move from anger, anxiety, discouragement, depression into more love, joy, peace in our lives. Mm.
So then if you were to focus on one, probably one that is quite prevalent everywhere, is the one you mentioned about worry, anxiety, mm-hmm. as people look around today, whether it's kind of the financial downturn, you know, worldwide that we're hearing, that can push people down into somewhat of a discouragement, depression, and worrying about, you know, small things and large things. And so so maybe just take us a little deeper then into the idea of the anxiety and how we overcome that.
Okay. Well, I'm personally familiar with anxiety. Of all the negative emotions, I've probably struggled with that the most. And the reality is that even after we've been a Christian a long time, I've been a Christian more than 30 years, we still have days when worry besets us and we have to deal with that. So using anxiety as an example, let me just share how I approached emotional management in this book. I think that God expects us to do our part, and He expects us to do our part first, but then He adds to that His empowerment through the Holy Spirit. And so if you take anxiety as an example, I love to quote Philippians 4, verses 6 and 7, mm-hmm. where it shows that we're supposed to do something and God's supposed to do something. And it's that combination that works. So in Philippians 4, verses 6 and 7, we're told, do not be anxious about anything, but instead, pray about everything with thanksgiving. And then God will give us the peace that passes understanding. Mm-hmm. And then He will guard our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. So right within those few sentences, we can see the spiritual principle that we have to do our part. We can't give in to worry and fretting and being anxious and just doing those kinds of thoughts and expect God to just somehow magically and mystically zap us with mm-hmm. peace. We can pray for peace, but if we're not willing to do our part in trying to put off those thoughts and stop thinking that way and instead substitute thoughts of faith and trust and peace in God, it's only then that the Holy Spirit can come and empower us from within.